All right, so we're gonna get started.
Everyone quiet down. Perfect. Thank you. That's a good audience.
So welcome to our second lecture of the spring 2012 season. As most of you probably know, because I see lots of familiar faces, we are actually very lucky to have the support of the Lowell Institute to make sure that this is free and open to the public for as long as everybody wants to keep coming. My name is Gina Cerrito. I'm lucky enough to coordinate these lecture programs. And we have a fantastic lineup for the spring of this year. So we have some brochures and there's a mailing list out in the hallway. So we highly recommend that you join and pick up a brochure. If you already know about it, bring a friend next time. Or give them the brochure. Put it up at work or however you want to do that. But we do like to see new faces. How many people here tonight, this is their first lecture?
Woohoo!
Yes. Nice! A little excitement. You can tell that our staff loves having people, new people here. How many are members?
Woohoo!
Oh my goodness. This is amazing. This is a great audience. Very excited. Oh, and before I forget, if everyone can silence their phones, we'd very much appreciate that. And as always, here at the lectures, we are working to make the lecture series heavy on knowledge and light on the earth. So we offer recycling and composting as part of our refreshment service that we do after the lecture. So let me know if you have any questions, but that's out in the hallway, so we try to do lots of different things during the lectures. Our next lecture is actually next Thursday, March 22nd, and it will actually feature also, again, some of our staff that are from our Sea Turtle Rescue and medical team. They'll be talking about kind of what they do when they're out in the field, but then what happens when the sea turtles are brought back to the aquarium and kind of the rehabilitation process that it goes to. So that's next week, but for tonight's lecture, we're very excited to have Paul Leonard and Jo Blasi. So in 2010, the African penguin became listed as an endangered species, and since then, conservation groups have been working to rehabilitate injured or abandoned animals to ensure the species' survival. This past fall, Paul and Jo traveled to South Africa to learn more about the work that is being done at the Southern African Foundation for Conservation of Coastal Birds, or SANCCOB. So you can use that instead. Luckily, Paul and Jo didn't have to finance this amazing trip on their own. They were recipients of the 2010 John H. Cunningham Award. Jack was an employee of the New England Aquarium for many years and helped to create a positive and encouraging culture among the staff members. In 1979, this award was created to continue his legacy of encouragement by allowing staff to find individual programs of self-directed professional enrichment. Other past recipients have traveled to Alaska to study northern fur seals, earn additional diving certification in Honduras, and immerse themselves in another culture to better serve our guests and visitors, and many other interesting projects. But we are very lucky at the Aquarium Lecture Series to have these exceptional staff members each year share their experiences. So without further ado, I pass it on to Paul and Jo.
All right, well, thank you very much for coming this evening. Jo and I are really excited to share this this amazing trip that we had. We're very passionate about these animals, and we're hoping tonight to give you some insight on the work that's going on the front lines to help protect them and some of the work that we got a chance to experience. But before we get into a lot of the details, I just want to give you a little bit of a background information about the African penguin. The scientific name for the African penguin is Sphenisciscus demersus, and in the Sphenisciscus family, there are four different species. So sometimes this particular penguin can get confused. The species are the Magellanic penguin, which is found in around Argentina, the Humboldt penguin, which is on the Peruvian side of South America. You have the Galapagos penguin, which is in the Galapagos Islands off the coast of Ecuador, and of course the African penguin, which is found in South Africa. There's a family of penguins otherwise known as the Harlequin family of penguins, and this happens to be because of the distinct black and white plumage that you see on them. Other common names that you'll hear these penguins being referred to are jackass penguins, and beach donkeys also. This is because of the braying sound that they make. It's a very dramatic, hee-haw, almost donkey-like sound. And another common name that you'll hear African penguins being referred to as the African black-footed penguin. And that's because of the black coloration, the markings that you'll see on the tops of their feet. Now, an interesting characteristic about this particular species is that it's considered to be a burrowing penguin. And that means it likes to take advantage of going under substrate, digging below the earth, and trying to hide its nest away so to protect itself from the elements and predation. And as I mentioned, they're only found in Africa, specifically along the shores of Namibia and southern Africa. Now, the African penguin has had a pretty rough time in recent years. In the turn of the century, meaning the 1900s, these animals were exploited for their eggs and the guano that they produced. The eggs were considered to be a delicacy, and it even goes on record that in one colony, 600,000 eggs were recorded being taken in one harvest. And I also heard that sometimes to regulate market prices, because these eggs were considered to be were held in such high regard, people would sometimes destroy big stores of it just to make sure the prices were right. Also, guano was a big harvesting of the guano produced by penguins has led to a lot of the problems they've had. Before artificial fertilizers, bird guano, meaning all different types of seabird guano, was considered to be a really good source of nitrogen for crops. So many of the African islands where the penguins and other seabirds lived, the guano was strip mined so they could harvest it and sell it to other parts of the world. They basically considered it, or they called it, white gold. Now, penguin guano alone is not super potent, but when you combine that with seagulls, other types of nesting birds in the area, all that mixes up to make a really strong fertilizer. In some areas, because these birds had inhabited these colonies for thousands and thousands of years, in some areas the layers of guano were feet thick deep, potentially 6 feet in some areas. So it does destroy, a lot of those were destroyed in just the span of a little less than 100 years. But in the late 1960s, there was a big movement to stop these practices, and everything for the African penguin was banned in the late 1960s. So bringing things forward, just to give you how the change of the status of how they've been in the wild. In the 1900s, the African penguin population was estimated to be somewhere around 1.5 million to almost 2 million birds in the wild. As of last year, earlier as this year, that number is now down to 40,000 individuals living around South Africa. So their status in 1988, they were listed as a threatened species. In 2000, that status was changed to vulnerable. And with the current rate of decline as of 2010, the status got changed now to an endangered species. With the trend continuing going forward, it has the potential of going extinct in the wild in only 13 years. So what's the problem today? If everything else was banned, why are they still facing hardships? Well, South Africa, the southern part of Africa, is exposed to high shipping, commerce, lots of tankers and cargo ships travel through this area. So these animals are constantly put in danger with the risk of oil spills. In the last 20 years, there's been two major events. In 1994 was the Apollo Sea, where it affected over about 10,000 African penguins. And they really didn't even, people didn't know that this ship disappeared until they actually saw the penguins coming ashore covered in oil. It was the first time that rehabilitators had to deal with such a mass event involving these animals. And so only about half of those penguins, about 5,000 of those penguins, were able to rehabilitate and release back to the wild. Flash forward to 2000, a very significant event that affected the majority of the remaining population was the treasure oil spill that actually took place, it happened in roughly the same place where the Apollo Sea went down. This affected two different colonies, the one colony on Robben Island, which was about 19,000 birds. These penguins were completely oiled and had to be relocated and rehabilitated to Cape Town. And then the other colony was Dassin, which was further up the coast because the oil slick was moving its way north. Rescuers relocated those penguins there to the opposite side of South Africa, to the eastern shores, so that the theory was if they released them on the eastern shores, that they could, by the amount of time that it took them to travel back to the Western Cape, they would be able to clean up all of the oil. So that happened in 2000. What are they experiencing even today? There's still these mystery spills. They're not as significant as these two major oil spills, but there's usually, it involves a couple hundred birds at a time, and the rehabilitators find these birds all over. These penguins are dealing with habitat loss. South Africa's economy, they're really, really working hard to build a very strong economy and infrastructure, and as a result, they're expanding out, they're developing, and of course, this is going to encroach on the penguins that live in that area. Climate change, it's affecting all of us, and it's definitely affecting South Africa, and competition with fishing seems to be a really, really big challenge for these penguins. So to get into what exactly is being done to help save them, I'm going to switch over now to Jo, and Jo is going to tell you what we started off doing.
All right, well, thank you again, everyone, for coming tonight. Now, one thing that should be clear, Paul is part of our penguin staff. He's one of those responsible for taking care of our birds here at the aquarium. I am not. I'm an educator. I do enjoy talking about our colony, and I actually do a lot of that. My job in the building is to interact with visitors. I tell them all about our exhibits, help to make them connect in some way, and as one of our most popular exhibits, I do end up talking about a lot with our penguins. Now, what's really great about our exhibit is that we're able to use our birds here sort of as ambassadors to talk about the problems that are happening in the wild. People come to the aquarium, they have a very visceral, oh, they're so cute sort of reaction, but they don't understand the backstory of what's happening. So that's one of the great things about our colony that we can really explain some of those big issues like overfishing, like climate change, and the way that they're impacting the birds in the wild. We can also talk about our breeding program. We have a pretty successful species survival plan with our African penguins. It's a breeding program that we work in conjunction with a lot of other zoos and aquariums in the US and throughout North America. So we're able to talk about the struggles and the successes with that program as well. So in thinking about my proposal for this particular project, I wanted to see and sort of take it full circle. I really wanted to travel to South Africa, see what was happening with these birds, being able to bring their story back to Boston, and also to explore some of the other opportunities and other organizations that were doing work with penguins in South Africa. So off I went. Now, being an aquarium educator, the first place I had to go was an aquarium. Fortunately for me, there's a great little aquarium in Cape Town called the Two Oceans Aquarium. It's very similar to us in that they sit right on a working harbor. They have a lot of tourists as well as school children and local people that come visit. And they also have two species of penguins that we have here as well. They have the short crested or the southern mockhopper as well as the African penguin. So there was a lot of overlap and it made sense to travel there. The New England Aquarium's education department also has a long-standing relationship with their education department. So I was able to go and see what they do, what they talk about, and lo and behold, they pretty much discuss a lot of the same issues that we discuss here back in Boston. They talk a lot about overfishing, which is a huge problem off the coast of South Africa. South Africa also has a sustainable seafood program, very much like we do here in Boston at the New England Aquarium. They also talk a lot about water conservation and sort of overall consumerism within the country, as well as things like marine debris, and certainly climate change is a huge part of what they talk about as well. Now, one thing that's interesting about the population of African penguins at Two Oceans is that they are all wild birds. They were all collected in the wild and rehabilitated to the point where they could be. Now, for whatever reason, they were deemed unreleasable, so they then came to the aquarium. And what's really cool is they have mates and they have a breeding program there as well. So when those African penguins mate and produce a chick, those chicks then go to the Southern African Foundation for the Conservation of Coastal Birds, or SANCCOB, which is where Paul and I overlapped in our project ideas. So just a little bit of information about SANCCOB. It was established in 1968. Sort of the main mission points is that they prepare and manage the rehabilitation of seabirds during major oil spills, such as the 2000 Treasure Spill. They collaborate on lots of research projects. They do some rehabilitation of oiled and injured birds at their facility. They also artificially raise orphaned seabirds, such as African penguin chicks, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And again, of course, they raise awareness of conservation issues through their education efforts. So here are some cast of characters. Here are the staff of the facility. There's only about 15 staff in different areas, including administration and development. They do have two education staff that provides educational programming, both for local school children as well as other people who come to the center. A lot of their staff fit in with the veterinary and rehabilitation crew. And of course, there's groups that staff that work with the massive amount of volunteers that come through the building. Now, here are some of what they call volleys, or those volunteers that come work at the center, looking a little less professional than the staff in the picture. Now, just like the New England Aquarium, they have tons of volunteers. They rely heavily on volunteers to do all of their operations. Just in December of 2011 alone, there were 32 individual volunteers that made their way through the center. Some of them are local. They come from the local Cape Town area. However, the majority of ones that we were there, including Paul and myself, were from international areas. And they came from all over the place, throughout Europe, North America, all the way from New Zealand and Australia. Now, what's interesting about the volunteer program there is that it sort of ranges in backgrounds of people that are there. There are people that worked at aquariums, worked with penguins like Paul and myself. There were people who were studying to be veterinarians or training to work in the field. There were also people who just wanted to volunteer and help out, and they sort of went online and looked for volunteer opportunities, came across this one and said, that looks cool, knew nothing about penguins at all, and decided to come to SANCCOB. So it was quite a vast group of individuals. And of course, the last group of characters is definitely the birds. We have some individuals here. The first two on the top are both African penguins. The rock hopper, her name was Rocky. She was quite a character. She was the education penguin at SANCCOB. She would just randomly walk around. And we also down on the bottom have some kelp gulls, as well as some of the birds being fed by one of the rehabilitators. Now, one thing that's really important to note about SANCCOB is that even though Paul and I are going to be talking mostly about penguins, SANCCOB is dedicated to rescuing all types of coastal birds in the area. And this is actually the list that they had going as of through 2011. There were close to 30 different species that had come through the center, everything ranging from petrels to shearwaters, various different types of terns and gulls. African penguins was definitely the one that they saw the most of, but they did see lots and lots of different species. So we'll take you on a little tour of SANCCOB. It works. Aha. Welcome to SANCCOB, everybody. We're on the outside of the building, walking into their outside pen area. All the outside areas are pretty much covered in mosquito netting to help reduce the amount of mosquito interactions the birds receive. Now walking down into the outside pen area where the birds spend the majority of their day. Making our way to pen two. These are the birds that are closest to being released. Now, because they do have a lot of flighted birds that come through the building, they need to make sure that there's a space for them to sort of stretch their wings if they need to, and this is the aviary which lets them do that. These are kelp gulls that actually got released about a week after the video was taken. Now, because there are sometimes the birds cannot be released because of their conditions, there wouldn't be a great chance of surviving. SANCCOB does have a very large home pen area where those birds can stay for a long time. They also, again, do have mated pairs that do indeed lay eggs and have chicks. Hanging out poolside. Here are some of the chicks. Now, some of them come in fairly small. When they small to me, they look like little mini dinosaurs, and they hiss. Check this face out. Dinosaur! This is the emissions area. This is where birds are first processed. And then many of them will spend at least a night or two in our intensive care units. The intensive care unit, it's actually empty right now because most of the birds in ICU are spending their time outside. They try to get them as much fresh air as possible, including this little guy. This bird was doing pretty good. He was a little underweight and very dehydrated when he first came in. He's obviously doing better. Now, one thing that was really amazing when we were there is they opened their chick hatchery area. Up to this point, SANCCOB had raised the really, really small chicks with the help of a woman in her private home. So this whole building had been 20 years in the making. They opened it while we were there. So now they're going to be able to raise even those small, small chicks on site. And of course, Rocky gives her seal of approval. Rocky was everywhere. She was sort of the unofficial mascot of the center. Paul and I, on our first day, were a little nervous. We all walk in, and there in the middle of the hallway directing traffic is this rockhopper penguin, so it was pretty funny. Now, one thing that SANCCOB is well known for is indeed responding to those oiling events and treating oiled birds. They were instrumental in the treating of the 2000 treasure spill. So many people from all over the world helped with that international rescue event, including some of the people in this room this evening. Over 19,000 penguins were cared for during that event, and it really just sort of brought the entire community together. Now, during our time at SANCCOB, there was actually only one oiled bird, and that is a Cape Gannet. And if you are not familiar with what they look like, here's a picture down at the bottom. They are beautiful birds. They have this bright blue eye, sort of cream white colored body with really cool yellow feathers on their head. Unfortunately, this is what our Gannet looked like when he was there. Here he is in the top inside a crate in the intensive care unit. What's pretty amazing about this bird is when he came in, the staff gave him about 24 hours to live. They didn't think he was going to make it. His blood proteins were totally bottomed out. His electrolytes were all over the place. He was anemic, extremely dehydrated, very lethargic. They thought he wasn't going to make it. Well, he totally went against the odds and got better and better and better over time. And he got to the point where he could stand on his own, and they were able to move him outside for a period of time. Now, in the bottom picture, he's stabilized. He's doing much, much better. But in order to wash the oil off, they need to make sure that the birds can go through that process. They can withstand the stress of that particular process. So they want to make sure that blood levels and everything are, become a lot better before they clean them. Now, fortunately for him, he was deemed okay to be clean. So here he is during one of his cleanings. You can see some of the materials that they used to clean the birds with on the bottom. You can see these big gray washing tubs. They were filled with nice warm water. They want to make sure that the birds can stay nice and warm during this process. Oils many times can decrease the waterproofing of the feathers, so they can get really, really cold very easily. Something as simple as a toothbrush makes a perfect scrubbing tool to get in to clean some of those feathers. And the bright orange liquid is the cleaning solution that they use for those birds. It's a combination of soaps, emulsifiers, and of all things, canola oil to actually help remove the oil from the feathers. Now, while the staff are washing the birds, they need to make sure that they wear protective gear. Oil is very harmful to pretty much everybody on the planet. So they need to make sure that they're well protected. It was important to note that all of the protective gear they wore was a separate set of gear, so that way they only used it while cleaning the birds. So that way they wouldn't contaminate any other animals with oil in the process. Again, the tub water was kept really warm. Once the animals were washed, they put in a separate pen to dry out. And it many times does take a lot of washing to get him clean. So here's the bird after one washing. They actually managed to get a lot of oil off of him. You can tell he still has some oil on his back feathers and along his head. But because he had been washed enough, they actually allowed him to swim for about 10 minutes at a time, helped gain his strength back. And they made sure to swim him after all the other birds had swam to prevent any contamination. So after a few days, they actually deemed him to be okay and they washed him again. It's kind of hard to tell which one's which, thank goodness. The oiled bird is the one on the right, the one standing up. If you look closely, you can see there's still a little bit of staining along his head. That staining will disappear over time. And what was really cool is that we found out after both Paul and I got back to the States, this bird was released. which was really cool. So he went from being given about 24 hours to make it, to being washed, to being released. So it was pretty cool. Now, one of the things that Paul and I were really interested in about SANCCOB is what they call their chick bolstering project. This is where SANCCOB will help take in orphaned penguin chicks, raise them to the point where they can be on their own, and then hopefully release them into the wild. Now, why are these chicks being abandoned to begin with? Well, the penguin chicks are taken care of by their parents. Parents help feed them until those penguin chicks develop enough so that they gain their waterproof set of feathers. Once that happens, mom and dad say, thank goodness you're on your own, have a good life. Now, right after that happens, penguin parents will molt their feathers. It's something that penguins do every year. They will lose all their feathers on their body and grow in a new set that ensures that their feathers are in perfect condition, keeps them waterproof, keeps them dry, keeps them nice and warm. So they need to do this every year. But they don't go to sea to eat during what many times is close to a 3-week process. So before those birds molt, they have to put on a few extra pounds. That way they have enough reserves to get them through that molting period. So they need to go out and find food. Well, because of the major overfishing concerns off of South Africa, because of currents are shifting due to climate change and are pushing those food sources further and further, parents are having to travel further to find food. And what ends up happening is they abandon their chicks before they are ready. Now, fortunately, there are lots of local groups, whether it's government agencies or nonprofits that work in these areas. They know that this is happening. They can find abandoned chicks, bring them to SANCCOB, and then SANCCOB sort of takes over as a surrogate parent, making sure that they can raise those chicks up until the point where they become what they call a blue. They've gotten all of their waterproof feathers in. They make sure they're nice and healthy, and then again, hopefully are released. So here are some birds that got admitted as part of that process. The two on the left-hand side, you can tell, still have a lot of their downy feathers left. So they are not waterproof in the slightest at the moment, again with all that downy feathers. The two on the right-hand side, those were a little bit older and probably were only have to spend a couple of weeks at the center before they could get released. So we saw chicks from very, very young that again were taken care of in that woman's home all the way up into the birds that only had to spend a couple of weeks at the center. So after the birds come in, they are admitted, they go through a full health check, and then starts the fun stuff of trying to take care of them. So the sort of daily schedule went something like this. 7:45, everybody gets together for their morning meeting. The volunteers get their assignments for the day. You take a deep breath because you know it's going to be a crazy day. You put on your BRPs, which I always like to call the big rubber pants. You're going to see a picture of those in a bit. And then you go. 8 a.m. means medication, tube feeding the birds Darrow's. Essentially, it's penguin Gatorade. Nebulizer treatments for those that needed it. 9 o'clock equals more hydration for birds, particularly the ICU birds. You need to do some fish preparation and clean pens. Penguins poop a lot, which means lots of cleaning. 10 o'clock is time for swimming the birds. It's also time to make sure that your food prep is done for the day. 10:30 is feeding time. 11 o'clock, formulas. A lot of the birds come in very underweight, so they get fish milkshakes. Throughout the day. ICU birds would get them a little bit more often than others. It was pool party time. It's not as fun as it sounds. And you also get tea break if you're lucky. 12 o'clock meant more medication, more hydration, more nebulizers for those who needed it. 1 o'clock was tubing more formulas, lunch if you got it. 2 o'clock was more swimming and more food prep. 2:30 was feeding time. 3 o'clock you needed to update all of the medical charts for every bird that you were treating throughout the day. And that included making sure that their medical charts were up to date, the medications that they were getting was right for the next day. And you also had to do a little more cleaning. Penguins poop a lot. 4 o'clock, more medication, more penguin Gatorade, more nebulizer treatments. 5 o'clock, tubing of formulas. I need to put the birds to bed. Cleaning, 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 and more cleaning. Oh yeah, and there's all the other stuff that happens every day. Including bleeding all of the birds on Monday to look at their blood counts. The vet did her full checks on Fridays. They did releases on Tuesdays. You admitted birds whenever they came in. You helped make fish formula because it takes a lot of work to make fishy milkshakes. Clean dishes and do laundry. Needless to say, you pretty much ran around for close to 12 hours a day. Now here are some of the pictures from the day. I'm taking part of feeding time. I'm feeding one a penguin who's in my lap right now. Paul is officially taking part of that pool party, which essentially meant cleaning the pool with a disinfectant. lots of different types of medications down on the bottom, and the ever-present pile of laundry. Some more things for the day. Here I am tube feeding some birds. The tubes look like the top right corner. Again, a lot of the birds came in very underweight. This formula essentially was fish in a blender with a bunch of vitamins. Helped the birds put on a lot of weight very, very quickly. There's also food prep for all the other birds, including some of those kelp gulls that we saw earlier, and that's what their food prep looks like on the bottom. Now, all of this hard work, sweat and tears and turmoil, all goes into hopefully being able to release birds back to the wild. That's the end goal. And hopefully they try to do a release as often as they can, at least once a week. Now, in order to be released, birds have to make a certain weight requirement. Most of the time it was a little over 5 pounds. Their feathers needed to be waterproof. What they would do is they would let the birds swim in the pool for an hour and then actually look underneath their feathers. They would see if the downy part of their feather was wet. If it was wet, not quite ready yet. If it was dry, meant their waterproofing was good to go and they were close to release. They also needed to make sure any sort of other medical problems had been cleared up, whether it was blood tests to be cleared or things like cuts healed with feathers grown back in. Now, before the day, on the day of release, before they released, many of them had their heads measured as part of long-term health assessments. They also got a pink spot on their belly to help identify these birds as ones that had recently been released. That pink spot does not stay on them forever, only a little while, so don't be concerned. Also, for some of the birds, if the birds had come in as chicks and then grown into blues, they had metal bands that were put on their wings, you can see in the top picture. These were only done, again, with birds that came as chicks into SANCCOB. Each one had a unique number, and it helped scientists and other conservationists sort of track them in the wild to see where they were going and how populations were doing. Once everybody was all set, you box them up, and off you go. Now, most of the boat releases they tried to do off of Robben Island. On a boat. The stretch of weather that we had during the time we were going to release our birds made it impossible to go there. Cape Town is extremely windy and they can have crazy seas at any given moment, so they decided a boat release wasn't the best thing to do. So my release, the release that I was lucky to be a part of, happened on Boulders Beach. Now, Boulders Beach is part of the National Park Service. It is a little bit south of Cape Town. It is part of the peninsula that's down there. It is one of two mainland colonies in South Africa where you can find birds. Most of the African penguins are on offshore breeding islands. Boulders, however, you can pretty much walk right up to them. So half of the beach of Boulders is protected, restricted access. That is so that the birds have an area that is restricted just for their breeding areas. The other half of the beach is a public swimming area. So you could go, bring your families, have a picnic on the beach, and have a penguin walk by. Now, wherever you have penguins and people meeting, of course, you have funny signs that pop up, include, please look under your vehicle for penguins, and please do not introduce yourself to penguins. So here are some pictures of Boulders. The picture on the left-hand side is from the conservation restricted area, looking down towards the beach area. Because that restricted side is really hard to access, we release the birds from the swimming side. So you line all the boxes up, sort of release them. Most of them go willingly out of the boxes. The one little penguin on the bottom sort of had to be helped a little bit down towards the water. Now you notice in the next picture, on the top, you'll see most of the birds are blue penguins. Those are penguin chicks that have, this is their first set of waterproof feathers. This is their first time in the ocean. They haven't been swimming. They've been swimming in the pool at SANCCOB, but they haven't really been to the ocean before. It's kind of a new experience. So one thing that they try to do with all of the releases is release one adult with each group. The adults have been in the ocean, they know the program, they know what's going on, and they're able to sort of help lead the group out into the ocean. So you can tell there's the adult leading everyone up towards the front. Now, fortunately, this was a successful release. The group is seen together swimming for about 25 minutes after release. They sort of swim off around the corner into the sunset. What's really cool is that 4 of the 9 birds that were released actually were back home. They had come from Boulders initially, so they had been returned back to their spot. So it was really, really cool to see all the hard work and energy that we put into these birds travel out to the ocean. So it was a really, really great feeling. It was a great time to spend at SANCCOB and see the really, really amazing work that they do. One thing that was hard is that when you were walking along through boulders and you could see penguins everywhere, it was hard to remember that these birds are having an extremely hard time, that they could be extinct by 2025. It was hard to remember that. There's penguins everywhere. You'd walk by a boulder, penguins. You walk around the corner, more penguins. So it was hard to remember that. So that's why the work of SANCCOB is so hard, again, to put as many penguins back into the wild as they can. But it's also really important to sort of focus on the long-term studies, both at boulders as well as those important offshore islands, breeding islands that sort of dot the coast. And that's actually the work that Paul has done that he's going to tell you about next.
So yeah, so as Joe said, we were working together. We had some overlap with our projects at SANCCOB. I wasn't there as long as she was. My time there was just over a week. It actually ended up being a few more days because as she explained, the weather can be very unpredictable. And the place that I was going to next was one of the offshore colonies. And I mentioned earlier Dassin Island as being one of those. Dassin is located about 34 miles north of Cape Town. It's only about 5.5, almost 6 miles off the coast. And it's a really interesting island. The topography makes it very, very unique. It is completely windswept. There's very little vegetation on it. Many of the other colonies have a lot of structure, a lot of trees, a lot of vegetation, which allow all different animals to kind of hide away. That's not the case on Dassin Island. And just to give you an idea of how crazy the winds can get, when we were there, depending on where you're in Cape Town or on Dassin Island, the wind gusts would average about 25 to 30 miles an hour. And on a really nasty day, it would I think one day it went up to 60 when I was standing on the island. So it's really, really interesting. The other interesting fact is because it doesn't have any structures for the animals to hide, but because of that nice wind coming off the cold water, and the water that you see here, the average ocean temperature is between 50 and 55 degrees, it provided a very cool environment for the penguins. So what I didn't realize when I was talking to researchers who are working there is that the penguins on this island successfully breed all year round. Most penguin species, especially the African penguin, generally breeds during the cooler breed during the cooler months of the year so they have better success. The summer months tend to be really a lot hotter for those birds. So this was interesting is that these penguins here didn't have some of the problems that some of the other colonies made. The other thing that I did not realize, and I was it was such a privilege to get a chance to team up with people here, is that this island is completely off limits to the public. It's regulated and managed by Cape Nature Reserves, which do a lot of the preserves and lands environmental importance or conservation importance around South Africa. The other interesting thing I learned is that this island is completely off the grid, meaning it's got no electricity aside for a couple generators. There is a lighthouse that you can see off in the little corner of the picture there. But other than that, we were going pretty much on our own. I had to plan out food for myself for at least 10 days, and you had to plus or minus 5 days of extra food in case you got stuck. Drinking water too. And any other type of water that we use was collected through rain, so we recycled the rainwater. And it's also important to note that it's not just the African penguin that is monitored in this area. There are 9 other types of seabirds that were being managed under conservation plans. Some of the most notable is the great white pelican, who nest on this island, one particular area, and the only other island in Africa, or definitely in the southern half of Africa, that it nests on is St. Croix Island on the opposite side of the coast on the Eastern Cape. The other very important species that's being monitored in the area is the African oyster catcher. So to give you a brief history of the island, for centuries mariners have become marooned on this island as a result of the weather and its rugged coastlines. There are tons of shipwrecks all over its shores. Lots of debris, lots of garbage as a result. The name itself, Dassin, comes from the word, the local word Dassi, which is named after a small mammal, which we actually refer to or call the hyrax or the rock hyrax. This animal is a very small, about guinea pig size, and its closest relative is actually the elephant. You will see them, they do live all over the coasts of southern Africa. You also see them on Table Mountain. The Dasi, because the people would be marooned for countless periods on the island, the Dasi was actually hunted to extinction. There are no Dasis on Dasin Island now. They did, people, because there was a potential of more people being stranded on this particular rock, they did introduce rabbits so that there was always a source of food for people to use. And back in the 1900s, just to recap, there was possibly close to 1 million African penguins living on Dasin Island alone, which made this particular island one of the major, if not the chief producer of eggs and natural fertilizer. So, just to give you a little layout of the island, this area here, I don't know if you can see it. House Bay is the protected side of the island. So most of the ships that do come in to drop off supplies and gear do go into this area. Any other type of part of the shoreline is very rough, very rugged, and it's very, very difficult to make any type of landfall. That's where usually a lot of the ships tend to end up. Now you'll notice that this island is mapped out into different grids. This one line that goes all the way around the interior here, this is an actual man-made concrete wall. It stands about a foot and a half, almost 2 feet in some places. People made this because they wanted to keep the penguins on the outer rim of the island. They wanted to keep them in certain areas so they would make the eggs easier to collect and the guano easier to harvest. But if you remember from my very first slide, people didn't really realize, or they forgot the fact that penguins, especially African penguins, are a burrowing species. So they just dug underneath the wall. The line that divides the island right there is it's a dirt road. And down here in the south, where it says Whale Bay, that little outcrop of structure right there, that's the famous iconic Dasin lighthouse. And then up here is where I stayed in the little houses up by House Bay, which were somewhat protected. So as Joe introduced you to the characters at SANCCOB, here's the characters that I saw on my trip out there. This is what a Dasi looks like. They are found in the town that is very right offshore to Dasin and Iserfontein. Up in the top corner there is all the rabbits that we'll see. And there's a reptile, a tortoise, called the Angula tortoise that people feel has been there since, for centuries, for thousands of years. It was probably there. It got introduced here when the island was actually attached to the mainland. The island itself is considered to be a leftover caldera from an extinct volcano. So it's quite an interesting geology across this particular region. There's a picture of the great white pelican. In the middle there is the African oyster catcher, which is a really beautiful bird. If you're really into birding, this is a really an awesome species. They have bright orange beaks. They have really bright eyes, and they have this really cool chirp that they make. Off the far right there is some Cape fur seals or southern fur seals. They are starting to take residence on the island, so we had them. The keepers had to make sure, or the stewards of the island had to make sure that the seals were interrupted every day. Of course, we had African penguins all over the island, and then loads of other types of seabirds like kelp gulls, heart loves gull, leeches, storm petrels, arctic terns, herons, and one of my favorite birds, and this is, I'm saying this with full sarcasm, the glossy ibis. If you ever imagine waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning to a screeching banshee, this is the glossy ibis. Yeah. I recommend everybody get one. They're really expensive. So ladies and gentlemen, I've talked about Dasin. I just want to give you a quick tour of Dasin. Thank you. Feel free to dance if you want. I do have time. Dasin. It was really a cool experience. But why? What was the main reason why I was there? Well, this is it. I've worked at the aquarium for over 10 years now, and I've got a really good experience helping raising the African penguins that we have here. And what my goal was to join up with these field researchers and apply that experience for their work, and basically be their assistant, do exactly what they needed. And the advantage was that they didn't have to train me on any restraints. I knew the behavior, I knew exactly what, and they were really, really happy that I was able to join them because they were able to get a lot of their work accomplished in the short amount of time that we were on the island. So I teamed up with two biologists. One was Lisa Visashi from the Southern African Department of Environmental Affairs. And I also got a chance to work with Dr. Antia Steinford from the University of Cape Town, and I helped them collect penguin nesting data. We did a population study. And what that involved was looking at chick conditions, their growth, nesting success, resighting of the banded birds that you heard Joe talk about a little while ago. We did molt counts, and we also, which was really important for Dr. Steinfurst's work, was find individuals, watch their foraging behavior, and then deploy GPS trackers and loggers so that we can actually collect data on where they're foraging, how far they're traveling, and how deep in the water they're going. And once I said, the advantage of doing this is that these people going to Dasin is that because it's restricted, because of its climate, they can do long-term studies without minimal interference, which is very rare in field work. But the work is not as easy as it seems. You saw all those rabbits, and rabbits like to dig holes, so do the penguins. So we actually, in order to get out to the colonies, you had to walk, and it's not a lot of fun, actually. You get attacked by seagulls all the time. We had to walk in straight lines or follow behind each other because you could inadvertently step into a penguin burrow or crush a nest. So it was really, really important. And of course, as I said, not everybody was appreciative of the work. So you saw me with that stick. I was the tallest person of the three of us. And so seagulls attacked the highest point, and I had to walk around with a stick and basically wave it up so that the birds didn't attack us, they hit the stick first. This particular bird really hated me the whole entire time. No matter where I was on the island, and they can see fairly far, this bird's nest was actually about 300 yards away. But he definitely didn't want me there.
That's crazy.
Somebody.
So what were we trying to look for? These are what we were looking for. As I mentioned, the penguins burrow, and they really take advantage of the earth, the layers of guano. And it's, like I said, it was an extinct caldera on the island, so there's a lot of limestone deposits. So these are what their caves look like, or their hutches look like. They also took advantage of burrowing under boulders, so we'd have to check under anything that looked high enough that you could stick a penguin's head in. You'd have to look down into the hole with a flashlight to make sure there wasn't a bird in there. And then these limestone caverns were pretty popular with the birds. So how do you do a population study? How do you check these individuals out? This is how you do. And I swear, I just want to show you. You can see my wingspan? Watch this. You gotta listen to the commentary too. I'm wearing protective gloves. What we had to do is you had to reach down into the cave, you had to let the penguin bite onto you, and I had my hands out like this. They bite onto these two fingers, I clamp down, and slowly pull the bird out. Now the trick is you have to go slowly because the birds get tugs with you, tugs against you, and they could actually collapse the cave on top of them. You'll notice also that I was spreading myself out. There's multiple nests in here that you can't see that are underneath the little bushes and stuff. If I wasn't paying attention, I could inadvertently apply all the weight and collapse all of them. So it's like, the best way I can tell you is like if you're laying out a sheet of ice, you had to lay yourself flat out and kind of just spread your weight out. And that's what you had to do. Once the penguins were out, then we had to do some quick studies. We wanted to make sure that we had minimal interactions with them. So we had to be 1, 2, 3 and go. So we do weights, and that's what's happening right here. We're getting a weight on this particular chick. We'd measure their wings and their heads for growth, make sure that they're progressing as much as they should be. And then we also would check conditions of their feathers. Sometimes the chicks can get ticks and fleas, and we just wanted to make sure that everything was going well. And the really cool thing with doing this part of it, after hearing all that you've heard so far that these birds are having problems, these chicks actually had full bellies. They were good weights with my experience of raising African penguin chicks here for the size. They were doing really, it was really nice to see when we pulled them out, how well and how active and how normal they're supposed to be. So the other part of the work was deploying these trackers. This is where my expertise really came into play because the bird needed to be held completely still. So I would sit down on the ground, I'd cross my legs, and basically drape the bird over my body. And the surprising thing for me is that these birds are 100% wild. They've hardly ever been handled. I think they've never been handled. These birds would just fall asleep in my lap. They just would go limp. The ones that were the feistiest would sit there and stare at me once in a while, and then they would just watch the shadows. And when we were done with their work, we put them back in, and of course they were angry again. But they were back in their place. So here's how we did this. First, you got to get the penguin. This is not as dramatic as the answer. This is an adult penguin. Adult African penguin. The most dangerous part of a penguin, it's its head. So you would never let go of the head. So once you've got the penguin in place, what the Dr. Steinfurth is doing is she attaches gaffing tape underneath layer of the feathers, and we do it right along the spine, the back of the spine. The first tag that you're gonna see is a GPS tag. She cuts the tape specifically to wrap around the tag so it stays in place. And then the second logger is gonna be a depth logger and a temperature logger. And so we just didn't pick these birds at random. We had to watch to make sure that the parents were changing and feeding the chicks. So we wanted to make sure that they were on a regular pattern so that we could actually retrieve these devices back so she could collect the information that she needs to collect. So that's the depth and temperature sensor right there. She's talking about making a director's cut, so she did. Now we used, she sealed up the seams with super glue, and I had automatically, when I first saw this, I was like, whoa, what are you doing here? Turns out the super glue gets dissolved very quickly in the salt water. So the super glue is just insurance to keep the tape in place. If we weren't able to retrieve the loggers in time, they basically would fall off, and the glue would be on the tape itself would also fall off, so the trackers would be lost. So we had a very, very narrow window to collect each of the trackers back. It was Dr. Seinfurth's goal to try to deploy anywhere between 10 and 20 trackers over the course of the 10 days. And we were actually successful in doing about 14 on this particular trip. So here's, she was nice enough to loan me the data from one of the recent ones. This is from 2010. And this big color mass up at the top, that's Dasson Island, all the birds that she's tracked and their foraging patterns. Down here in the lower corner here, that's Robben Island, and right where that little hook shape is, that's Cape Town. So why is this important? What are we seeing here? What we're seeing is that this is where the penguins go to eat. This is how long they stay away from their nests and possibly how deep they go. And so what this information and what their biologists are hoping is that the more information they collect will help them create legislation to make these areas close to fishing. They're finding that fishermen, depending on the season, will be right up almost on the shores of Dasson. They'll be taking whatever fish that they need. And so by presenting this data, they'll hope to be able to change and make this area restricted. So I had a unique opportunity to work with these people, and being on an island with no electricity and no entertainment, we were forced to talk to each other. And I had lots of questions, so they were happy to entertain me. And one of the questions I had is, you know, people are gonna want to come and hear what we have to say. What is the message that you would like me to take back to the United States, and how can I get people to raise awareness for the work that you're doing? And they said that they're doing what they can, but this particular animal is in trouble, and they've got ideas, but they're not sure exactly why. As I mentioned, the African penguin on Dasson Island was one of the second largest colonies, and that number has significantly dropped. We saw numbers that they were back in 2000, just under 12 years ago, that there was 20,000 African penguins living here. Going back to the slide of the map, I just want to give you a little orientation for the next few pictures I'm going to show you. Up in the top corner, you'll see Area G. This is an area that had a lot of penguin colonies. Down here is Whale Bay. It was also a very, very highly populated area. And of course, House Bay, too. So these were the pictures that the researchers gave me. We've seen this one before. This is from the 1900s. And remember, there's over a million birds potentially there. This is what it looks like today. This is from the 1970s. This is today. And then the last picture, also from the 70s. That's today. So they said, the other part of the message they wanted me to say is, why should we save penguins? And when you look in the grand scheme of things, where do they fit in the food chain for the whole circle of life? And the reason why we want to save penguins, especially the African penguin, is that these are signals of changes in our world, changes of changes in the environment. And if we don't pick up on the signals first as they're happening, then that change is going to eventually affect us. And by that time, it may be past the point of no return. So what can you do living here in Boston? You can continue to live a greener lifestyle. Try to reduce your carbon footprint and pay it forward. Pick up trash when you see it. It won't get in the oceans. You can do what we do here at the aquarium, or what we promote is living blue. Protect the water, and you'll in turn protect the planet. And by taking these measures, even though our climates are changing and are warming up, the planet's warming up, by taking these small measures, it will give these changes will slow down. It will give these animals, like the African penguin, a chance to adapt to those changes. And also, as you saw Joe and I did, volunteer for what you believe in, what you're passionate about, especially in concerns of the environment. A little effort goes a long way. Specifically with African penguins, for everything that you've seen here tonight, from the work on Dasson Island to the work at SANCCOB, support SANCCOB. Anything that we can provide to them is very beneficial to the work that they do. Just to give you an idea, the SANCCOB's, a little idea about SANCCOB, their annual budget works out to be about $200,000. Their operating cost is $200,000 a year. And they do all this amazing work to save penguins. So with that being said, Joe and I would like to say thank you.